Greetings. My name is Dr. Waddell Brooks, Sr., your host, and this is Community Forum. This evening we have two special guests, but the Dr. John Minarcik, MD, a pathologist from Lake Bluff, Illinois. And good evening, Dr. Minarcik.
Good evening, Dr. Brooks. I'm very, very thrilled to be here.
I'm going to let you introduce our special guest. This is the first time we've had a special guest.
Okay. Well, our special guest is Woofy. Woofy is at my right hand. I think you could only see the back part of him.
Let Woofy turn around. He's not bashful.
Here's Woofy facing the camera. Woofy is my doggie. He rescued me from the ghettos of a Caribbean island that I taught medical school at and been with me now for 2 years.
He's shy with the camera there.
And he's camera shy, too. And, unless, of course, you put some food towards the camera, he'll probably look at it all hour.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Minarcik, the Woofy is so dear to him that we just could not deny him the opportunity to let Woofy be on the program with him. But Dr. Minarcik is a creator of the world's first free, real-time, global, complete medical school pathology course, 2010-2011. He's a director of pathology course, Scholes College of Medicine at Rosalind Franklin University, and he has many, I guess I could do a whole show on the, directorships that he's been involved in. But I'm going to start off by letting Dr. Minarcik tell us a little bit about his personal and professional background.
Okay. Well, I hope nobody will fall asleep, but I was born 65 years ago. I'm a Chicago boy. I grew up on the South Side, 18th and Racine, baby boomer, Catholic, went to school, high school, college, medical school, all in Chicago. Mm-hmm. And I, after medical school, I specialized in pathology because that's what I enjoyed the most during medical school. Mm-hmm. People that go into pathology are not people that love to work with dead bodies or necessarily introverts either. They're people who don't really get much joy or glory out of having their live patients think that they're God. They're just happy to do their scientific work quietly. And probably the best thing I've ever done in my life at that time was marry Barbara.
Okay.
We were married for 33 years, and she passed away 8 years ago.
Oh, so
but during that time, I had a very, very nice career in the private practice of medicine, pathology, and nuclear medicine. For a short time in Maryland and most of those years in Florida. And then when my wife got ill 10 years ago, I gave up private practice and I started teaching.
Okay.
And I've been doing it ever since. I directed the pathology course right here at our Scholl Medical College. And I taught the histology course at Rosalind Franklin for the medical students.
Mm-hmm.
And I also taught the anatomy labs, being a pathologist that cut up bodies his whole life. They thought I would be pretty good at showing the students what arteries, veins, and nerves looked like and what they were called.
Mm-hmm.
So I started out, I noticed that in my duties there, a lot of the things I did every year for 4 years were very repetitive. The same questions were asked.
Mm-hmm.
Under a slide, oh, what is this structure? Or in the anatomy lab, what is this muscle or what is this nerve? So I decided after being bored after a few years of doing that to make a bunch of movies. So I connected my microscope to my computer and I started making movies of the things that they should see, and I would point them out and talk about them.
Okay.
And I called that series Shotgun Histology because histology is the study of microscopic parts of the bodies, both normal and diseases as well, which is what pathologists do.
Okay.
And one of the students came into my office one day and she goes, you know, Dr. Minarcik, I would like to know why you called this shotgun histology.
Okay.
And I said, well, if you've ever shot a shotgun, you know that all those little dots go everywhere. There's no part of the target that doesn't have a dot on it. And I would like to think of microscopic structures as that way as well. So when you're looking at a brain or a kidney or a spleen or a pancreas, no matter where that little dot might land, you're going to know the name of it. Mm-hmm. So I shotgunned 96 different parts of the normal human body. And I made 96 movies, each one about 3 or 4 minutes. And as of today, those movies have now been seen over 11 million times mm-hmm. all over the world. And the natural consequence to that was also to teach online as well, not just movies, but real time. So when the webinar technology came around about 4 or 5 years ago, I did what I would normally do in a classroom. I would take, slides, and I would talk, and I would walk around, and I'd use my hands, mm-hmm. and I would point at things. And only now, rather than doing it in a classroom, where I have to shave and get dressed and, put on a little white doctor's suit,
okay.
I did it from home. And what I found is that the students could not only hear better and see better on these live webinars, but it was immensely more amenable for them, for their convenience as well. Mm-hmm. They didn't have to shave and fight the traffic and get a ticket from the campus police for parking in the wrong place or slip in the snow. They could just watch it at home from their bed. They could be playing video games at the same time or, laying on the couch with their girlfriend or boyfriend. Mm-hmm. So I know that this is the thing of the future, and I've been doing it now. This will be my 5th year, and I teach specifically in live, free webinars the science of pathology. Now, because I'm a pathologist, I think that it's appropriate to teach pathology. Mm-hmm. Here's a book, if you don't mind me picking it up. Okay. I may need a small crane to do it. Okay. This book is called Robbins and Cochran, Pathologic Basis of Disease. Mm-hmm. It weighs about 500 pounds, mm-hmm. and it's about 1,500 pages, and it covers all of the diseases, the common diseases known to man. It is written and edited, chief editor, by a man by the name of Vinay Kumar, who is my friend, who is the chief of pathology at the University of Chicago. Mm-hmm. And what I did was read the book. Now, because I practiced pathology for 30 years, okay. A lot of that stuff I knew already. But there's a lot of new stuff regarding genes and molecular aspects of pathology, which I learned myself. Mm-hmm. And because there's 30 chapters, and most of those chapters are organized with respect to part or systems of the body, like endocrine system or pulmonary system or renal system or female reproductive system. I just made a whole bunch of PowerPoints for the important parts of this book. Okay. And then I extracted them from these 1,500 pages. And Dr. Brooks, I want to show you this. Each page is like just chock full of material. Mm-hmm. Now, when a medical student is given this book in his second year of medical school, uh-huh. and he said, well, you have to know everything on here to pass your what they call board exam or licensing exam. Okay. They call it the STEP exam mm-hmm. or USMLE. Mm-hmm. It's a shock. So what my job is and has been for years now is to take the parts from this book or extract the parts that are the principles and the parts I know that have been asked before on previous questions and decide what is junk or what doesn't need to be mentioned. Mm-hmm. And my brain takes the book and it translates it into about 3,000 PowerPoints, about 30 chapters. And what I do is, what I have been doing for 4 years now, is every Tuesday and Thursday for a couple hours in the morning, I'll take one of those chapters or half of those chapters, mm-hmm. and I'll just show it like I'm in a auditorium in a regular medical school amphitheater. Mm-hmm. And that's the concept of what I do teaching online. Now, I've gone a step further this past year and a little bit different. I'm evolving into a system now where I am inside a regular medical school, American medical school classroom, and I'm the professor, and I have to shave and comb my hair and be awake and can't bring in my coffee cup. And I basically teach in the classroom, but at the same time I'm teaching and showing them things on the projection screen, I'm also wearing a wireless headset. So this past year in Puerto Rico, a large portion of the course was taught live in the auditorium. The Spanish word for it is anfiteatro, like amphitheater. And I was simultaneously broadcasting to over 2,000 registered students in 105 countries at the same time. This gives me joy like you wouldn't believe. And I haven't figured out how to make money yet, but I'm sort of retired, so I guess people think I don't need money. And it also, the thing I want to explain about it the most is that every single day I have 20 or 30 emails from students all over the world wanting to join my course or registering on YouTube for my movies, and massive gratitude letters. Now, I know that we need food to live on, but I feel I could just live on the gratitude itself. It's so overwhelming. So that's what I do, Dr. Brooks.
Well, I like to say this, though, at this point, and I may repeat it again, and you've heard me say it before, the things that you do for yourself leave with you when you're gone. But the things that you do for others remain as your legacy. And it's not like you're going to have a great, great legacy when you leave. I'd like to share one of the exhibits that you have here. I will respect the hard-won scientific gains of those physicians in whose steps I walk and gladly. And the key word here is share such knowledge as is mine with those who are to follow. And maybe we can show this on the screen and to give our viewing audience a little bit. You might want to talk to us about this.
Okay. Well, I can see it's on the screen.
Yeah.
And this guy that you see here, you may have heard of his name before. His name is Hippocrates.
Okay.
You may have heard that for generations, physicians have taken oath to this man, and because we feel that the profession of medicine is not just making money, it's devoting your whole life to a noble cause. And this is part of the Hippocratic Oath. When the physicians take the Hippocratic Oath, you know, some don't. Some think it's a hypocritical oath.
Okay,
some people
okay.
don't take it. Okay. I take it very seriously. Part of that oath is the word share. And part of what the medical students do when they put on their nice, stylish white coats and they raise their hand, they swear that they will gladly share their knowledge.
Okay.
Now, they didn't say sell their knowledge. They didn't say use Visa or PayPal. It's sharing. And I know a lot of people need, you know, to make their rent payments, even doctors do, or their mortgage payments or their car payments. But a lot of us who are sort of like the retirement age really want to give something back, and I can afford to do this for free. Now, I have approached several institutions like medical schools and corporations and foundations. And I go, hey, I teach medical school free all over the world. Would you like to support it? And I really have not really pushed that too much, but it seems like that type of thing just is not too popular. Most places, let's say, for example, Abbott Lab, because we're in North Waukegan, North Chicago. They have enough money to support 1,000 people like me. So when they get some guy saying, hey, do you want to support a free medical school? They think, well, what's in it for us? They think money, money, money. And Hippocrates did not say, think money, money, money. He said, think about sharing your knowledge.
And I've never seen a Brinks truck behind a hearse yet. If you think you're going to try to take it with you, you got a huge awakening. You're going to leave it there. Speaking of money, You have another exhibit here that you'd like to share with
us. Well, this is sort of like the negative part of what I'm going to talk about. Now, when students are lucky enough to go to medical school, they usually spend at that medical school more money than they have.
Okay.
The average student burden at our local medical school here, Rosalind Franklin, is over $250,000. So when they graduate from that medical school, they've already bought a house.
Okay.
And it's an enormous amount of money. The medical schools charge between $30,000 and $60,000 per year for tuition. And what I teach is like one half of one of those years. So if you're a second year medical student and you're taking your big, big, big pathology course, and Dr. Kumar says that over half of the questions on the licensing board are from pathology questions. So it's a big, big course. All of this goes to the medical school, right here. But you want to know how much that goes to the actual professors that are teaching inside of that box called a medical school? I've done some studies. I've seen it as low as 2%, and it's never more than 10. Okay? So if Hippocrates is saying to doctors, share your knowledge freely, then why are medical students going bankrupt in epidemic proportions? And the diagram here explains the whole rotten money scheme. I call this the axis of evil. Now, if you remember, there was a Bermuda Triangle, there was the slave trade, and money flowed historically from different points.
Yeah, rum, molasses, and slaves, you know, we remember that triangle.
Well, now it's called LCME Medical School and Licensing Exam, but it's the same principle.
Okay.
There is a branch of the American Medical Association, kind of independent, and it is called LCME, for the Licensing Committee of Medical Education. Actually, it's a liaison, but that's what everybody thinks LCME stand for. And LCME commission gives medical schools the sole monopoly right for their students to take this USMLE exam. So in other words, if you had a dog that was sick and died when you were 5 years old, and you want to be a doctor now, and you're paying all this money to the medical school, in order for you to practice medicine, you have to pass this exam. So the medical school is kind of monopoly. It's and all of these dollar signs mean that the person who pays all of this are the students. So I think it's a shame, you know. I have called the LCME and I've asked them to approve my course and maybe ease some of the tuition burden on the students, and they say, no, we only license medical schools, not courses. And I says, well, my course is, I think, is good or better than a lot of the medical schools I've been to. I says, does that mean you're subsidizing inferior education? And that's when they stop talking to me. So this is the axis of evil, and in the future, knowing that 90% of these poor students' tuition dollars go to the box rather than the person who teaches inside the box, I think now with this online revolution, I think a lot of that dead weight is going to be cut off. Now, you have never heard yet of an online medical school. You've heard of online law schools, online nursing schools, and that's because this commission is protecting the integrity of the axis of evil. It is inevitable that someday, some medical schools do have part of their curriculum online. It's starting to open up a little bit. But remember, if a medical school allows students to take their courses online, the students may start to say, well, then what did you do with my tuition money? So I am a revolutionary.
Well, Dr. Minarcik, I was looking at some of your most recent positions from August of 2004 to the present time, and one is the creator of the world's first free real-time global complete medical school pathology course, 2010-2011, director of pathology course at Scholes College of Medicine, Rosalind Franklin University. By the way, I knew the curator at Rosalind Franklin.
David.
I had his rose name down, so I wouldn't
forget. Very nice man.
Dave McKay.
Yeah, Dave McKay.
Dave McKay.
Very nice
man. He's retired now, but he was really interested in shows that he had there. A visiting clinical professor of pathology, American University of Antigua Medical School, Wisconsin. Professor of pathology, International American University, St. Lucia. Okay, West Indies.
Right, that's in the island of St. Lucia.
Okay, professor of pathology, Destiny University School of Medicine.
That's correct.
Visiting professor of pathology, University of Medicine and Health Sciences, St. Kitts, Wisconsin.
No, WI means West Indies.
West Indies.
St. Kitts, Caribbean. Yeah.
Okay. Workshop director of World Congress 26, Las Vegas, Nevada, October 20, 2011. Teach an entire global pathology course, lecture, and lab online. Current YouTube.com statistics, 9 million viewings of educational pathology videos, 11,000 medical student subscribers.
Right.
And all of this is free.
Right.
And they find out about you, just online?
Most of the medical schools in the world in their first year have a course called histology.
Okay.
It's part of anatomy. In other words, not just learning about, the arteries, veins, and nerves and muscles in the body, but what the tissues look like. Mm-hmm. What does a pancreas look like under a microscope? So they have these courses, and part of the course is a lab to show them slides.
Okay.
And most medical schools in the world have a large number of students that go to YouTube to watch my descriptions of these slides.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why they subscribe, because they like them, so they want to know when new ones come out. Mm-hmm. And it was 11,000, then it's 16,000 now.
Wow.
And those 9 million are now 11 million.
Wow. And everyone, like the certificate they can put on their wall, and there's a certificate of achievement for superior achievement, medical school of pathology, general and systemic pathology, 120 hours. This was the 15th of May, 2013, just this year, signed by Dr. Minarcik, MD.
Yes, this is their diploma. Now, what does it mean? Well, it's not going to get you a rebate on your $60,000 tuition,
okay. That's
for sure. And what it means is that I look at my attendance lists, online, and I know when they've come to most of the sessions.
Okay.
And I trust them. If they say, I could tell when they're online, if I see that they've been there,
okay. And
they say they've been to most of my classes, I give them the certificate. See, I'm a doctor, Dr. Brooks.
Okay.
I'm not a hall monitor.
Okay.
If somebody says, I don't force people to go to class, that's destructive. Some of the schools I taught at forced me to take attendance.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you can probably figure out what I told them. It's words I really can't use on television.
Okay.
And I believe that, to me, this is a great honor for them to say, well, I went through all 120 hours listening to that crazy guy Minarcik, and I really feel like I know pathology now. These may be students that are also taking pathology in some medical school in the world. The country which has the greatest numbers of these thousands of registrants is a country called the United States.
Mm-hmm.
India is second. Pakistan is third. There's an awful lot from Egypt. There's an awful lot from China. And there's probably half as many Europeans. Northern Africa is represented very well. The southern part of Africa has a relatively low attendance. Mm. But any student that can understand English, I hope, can attend and hopefully and even enjoy my course. Mm-hmm. And some of the students now that have taken their first year of medical school, that they learn about anatomy and physiology and biochemistry, what we call the basic sciences, they may be watching some of my movies before they get into their big second year curriculum, which is the lion's share is pathology, but pharmacology is very important. Okay. And so is microbiology as well. So those are the three biggies in the second year of medical school, is pathology, pharmacology, microbiology. In the first year of medical school, the two biggies are anatomy and physiology. But anatomy has a lot of branches like embryology and histology. And perhaps nowadays you might even think of biochemistry as a building block mm-hmm. to the body, molecules. And of course, physiology, I believe personally, is the single most important course for a student to take. Because, you know, if you're training a mechanic, you might show him what a carburetor looks like, but mm-hmm. it's up to him to understand how it works.
Mm-hmm. So a high school student that may be interested in pathology has a long ways to go, but that person, the high school student, would have to have a heavy background in science and mm-hmm. and math and so forth. But even at the college mm-hmm. level, a college degree, then they have to have certain
yes.
academic requirements.
If a college student or a high school student takes my course, he may be lost. Even okay. if a first-year medical student mm. takes my course, he hasn't had a proper basis in anatomy and physiology, okay. he may find it very difficult. So my prime audience is medical students, you know, before they put on their white coats
okay.
and go into the clinics. They have this course called pathology, which is integration of the basic sciences like histology and anatomy and physiology, mm-hmm. and their so-called clinical medical sciences.
What about minority students and women in the field of pathology? What is the percentage there?
Well, you know, originally when I was a medical student about 12,000 years ago, women went into pathology a lot, relatively speaking. At that time, there were only, maybe 20% of women in medical school, but a larger proportion went to pathology because they felt it was a little easier on their system. They didn't have to stay up all night with bleeding patients. Mm-hmm. They didn't usually get calls where they have to run out in the middle of the night. They could have their babies. They could have a life. Mm-hmm. They could have a family. And now, in 2013, at least 50% of all medical students are women.
50%?
Yeah, in some schools, Rosalind Franklin is a good example, it's slightly more than 50%. And I don't think that there's probably a few more women in pathology than, you know, the more physically demanding sciences, you know, surgery, you know, internal medicine.
What about African-American students?
Oh, I would not make any differentiation there. I would say African American students have the same desires and preferences and personalities as the non-African Americans, and they want to go into everything, you mm-hmm. know. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of people, males more than females, they want to be that surgeon. If you don't mind, I'll tell you a little story, and it reinforces what I said. Mm-hmm. One of the things that we do as a pathologist is we take samples of tissues
okay.
from people that are on the operating room table, and we look at it quickly under the microscope. It's called a frozen section because you have to freeze it in order to cut it real thin
okay.
under the microscope. Yeah. And I would do these frozen sections all day, and basically would then tell the surgeon whether it was malignant and he had to cut something out, okay. or whether it was benign and he could tell the patient you're going to live. It's a spectacular decision.
Mm.
And if it's a tough case, there could be a lot of pressure on it. Mm-hmm. Well, one time I went to tell the surgeon that a lung nodule was benign. It was just scar. It wasn't cancer.
Okay.
So he said, "John, you know, I have to go. Could you just go into the waiting room and tell the family yourself?" And I said, "Sure, I'd be happy to." Mm-hmm. Usually we let the surgeons get all the glory. So I walked into the waiting room with the patient, and I told the family, oh, it's not malignant, it's benign, you know, which for a pathologist is, you know, an easy decision usually. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And they were crying. There was some relatives there had been up all night, an aunt from Cincinnati, another one from Seattle. And they just, for about 2 seconds, Dr. Brooks, I felt like God. Mm-hmm. And somebody who needs to feel that way should not go into pathology. Because we let the surgeons have all the glory. We're just very happy to be sitting there and playing with tissues and looking at the microscope. And, oh, we can still save lives, but it's not drastic. When you do a pap smear on a woman mm-hmm. under a microscope, mm-hmm. and you can see a few early cells that might turn into cancer, and you report that, you might say you saved her life. Mm. But you'll never get the glory for it. And if you want the glory, don't go into pathology. And sometimes you can also kill a patient. If you report something out as benign, and then a couple years later, the patient comes back with metastases or spread of a tumor, and you go back and look at your original slides that you call benign, and you go, uh-oh, there's something there I didn't see. Uh-huh. Well, you know, I'm not going to say that it hasn't happened to me, but I will tell you it's happened to everybody. And if somebody says that, if a pathologist tells you that has not happened to them, either they never practiced medicine or they're lying.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Since you mentioned about tissues, I like to show a slide on the screen, and I like to warn the viewing audience that it's very graphic, and this is pertaining to Daryl Dagwood Hanna, a case that the whole county knows about. It's been in the local newspapers, you know, the picture there, the graphic picture, but the mother, Gloria Carr of Hannah, was affected by this, and she couldn't recognize her son because of he was just beaten to a pulp. It reminded her of the Emmett Till beating in, oh, I guess 1955 in Philadelphia, Mississippi, I believe it was, mm-hmm. you know. But we like to show this, but the audience have seen it already. But tell us, how did you, you're a pathologist, but I you came to several city council meetings where a lot of this was discussed, and the citizens and the area was so upset about it and still talking about it. It happened, the beating took place, I think it was the 6th of November of 2011.
Yeah.
And he passed away the 13th, just a week later, 13th of But tell us about your visits to the city council meeting. What did you think about this?
Well, I was completely disgusted and horrified, and really kind of disgusted in the United States that something like this could happen.
To a where graphic is on the screen now.
Okay. Well, I could see it. I'm a pathologist. Pathologists are doctors. Now, the pathologists that have dealt with this kind of thing are mm-hmm. called forensic pathologists. I'm not a forensic pathologist. I do regular pathology.
Okay.
But I've done some forensic cases. We're all in the business of saving lives and suffering.
Okay.
Patho-logos means the study of suffering.
Okay.
And we're all in the business of preventing this from happening again. I don't know how it came about going to my neighborhood city council meeting. It became very clear, I've gone repetitively now, mm-hmm. that six policemen murdered this man. The coroner was a former policeman, so he didn't call it murder. He called it undetermined.
Okay.
It was clear that it was a cover-up at the highest levels, not only the mayor, not only the chief of police, who has since then gone to jail for himself for something else.
No, he's been indicted.
Indicted, I'm sorry. But even at the state's attorney's level. The picture that they just saw on the screen is what I have here.
Okay.
And I also have had privy to see the report of the state's attorney.
Okay.
And I put a little circle around the two words at the conclusion of this report in which the state's attorney, or previous state's attorney, says the police utilized reasonable force to subdue and arrest Mr. Hanna. Well, I feel I wouldn't be doing you any justice today if I didn't ask this question. If that picture that was just shown is called reasonable force, where his own mother can't even recognize him, and he's beat to death, an unarmed man. Those are the undisputable facts. Then I would like to ask the old or current state's attorney, Mr. Michael Nurheim, what's his definition of unreasonable force?
Okay.
That's really the only political statement I wanted to make. I can't believe, you know, that this country I live in called America, in which we learned that there's something called justice and legal system, and when we go to the city council meetings every other week now, they've decreased them because there's been too much complaining about this.
Okay.
We stand up and we put our hand on our heart and we say at the very end, with liberty and justice for all. Well, I'm going to make the suggestion at the next meeting that they omit the part of justice for all. Because I don't know about America, but in North Chicago, there is not justice for all. There's no justice for Darren Hanna and his family. And that's my comment about that.
Well, she has filed a civil suit. Now, civil suit, I guess the evidence is not as stringent. Because she can probably get several millions of dollars in, from the civil suit, whereas it's going to be difficult for the, since the state's attorney has stated reasonable force have been used. But like you say, you have six policemen just beat him to death, unarmed, with his hands underneath him and so forth. I wonder what could an individual do to cause such severe beating? And that's what every week the citizens are, you know, complaining, you know, to the administration, to the mayor and city council. And, well, the mayor is almost as bad as the city, the state's attorney, because he said, I'm not going to fire these policemen. And the policemen are still walking the street. He didn't even put them on administrative leave until a decision was made. And so maybe that mayor should be, but he's accountable.
He is an accomplice. He's a conspirator to cover up homicide. That's exactly what he is. It's as clear as a bell. He should go to jail. State's attorney should go to jail. Anybody who covers this up, I've read all of the police reports. Okay. They're loaded with lies and contradictions, and nobody seems to care.
We have a young man, Ralph Peterson Jr., and did the investigation, and the information he got was from the police department, and they paid an investigator $30,000 to do an investigation, and they didn't use the material. But something is wrong here now. We're trying to, I guess we keep praying, and God we have is a just God, and this will be revealed itself in one way or the other. And I'm happy that you, of course, you don't have any axe to grind and so forth. You're a pathologist. And tell me, though, there's several causes of death. I guess one is what is undetermined, which was used, and the one was homicide, and undetermined, I guess, was
right.
One.
Classically, in forensic pathology 101, they teach you that there's four causes of death. that are not natural. So if you want to include natural, that's five.
Oh, natural.
One is natural. You die of cancer. You die of a heart attack. In the younger age group, natural causes are not the most predominant cause. Mm. The unnatural, like accidents, homicide, suicide. So those are four categories.
Okay.
The fifth one, of course, is undetermined. And that's fair, too, because if there's a thorough, honest investigation done and you don't find a cause of death, it's not wrong to say undetermined. We don't know. You know, that's being human. So out of those five causes, that's basically Dr. Rudd's job, is to determine honestly with his scientific training. He's the new coroner. Mm-hmm. He's a pathologist. He's a physician. He's a scientist. Mm-hmm. His job is to determine which one it is in without politics.
And this was a police officer that stated undetermined because he doesn't have the skills and the training
No, I think he knows it was homicide. I think if you took a three-year-old and you say, you see that man there on television? He died a week after the police beat him up. What do you think the cause of death is? I don't think it takes a rocket scientist or a pathologist or a physician or a board-certified forensics expert to tell you why Darren Hanna died. Mm-hmm. I think in what the coroner did is pay back a lot of political favors and call it undetermined. Thank God our new coroner, who's a physician, Dr. Rudd, called it like the three-year-old would have called it correctly. It's homicide.
Wow. You know, as a pathologist, excuse me, what are some challenging experiences that you've had? As I know you've probably had millions of them, you know, but...
Okay, well, I'll tell you one professional challenges I would probably put in several. I'll try to mention probably when you get a slide that's incredibly borderline. Now, most people think, most surgeons think, most families think that there's two kinds of tumors. There's benign tumors and malignant tumors, and the benign tumors don't kill you and the malignant tumors do kill you. Well, it's not really quite that way in medicine. There's this gray zone we call maybe pre-malignant or borderline malignant. They use the word dysplasia in pathology to mean the growth is funny, but it's not exactly cancer, but it could develop into cancer. Mm-hmm. So routinely, the most challenging things were to take these extreme borderline things and try to sort them out. Now, thank God we have consultants that we could send the slides to now and get another opinion. Mm-hmm. And those were probably, but let's say that you're doing a frozen section. Mm-hmm. And you don't have somebody from Mayo Clinic or, you know, Johns Hopkins to consult with during the frozen, you're really, really on the line. And that's very, very stressful. But the number one rule is, even if you think it might be malignant, you should never call it malignant unless you're 100% sure.
Okay.
Not 90, not 95, not 99. But 100. Because if you call it malignant and you're only 95% sure, that means that one out of 20 patients might lose this very big organ unnecessarily. Mm-hmm. I'd say that on the other challenges that I've had in my career, I've been directors of labs and chief pathologists and chairman at several different hospitals. Mm-hmm. It's been exciting, it's been fun. But, you know, whenever you relocate to a new area, it's not because you think you found something better. There's always a lot of politics behind that, too.
Okay.
Now, medicine, the business of medicine, the business of pathology is no different from any other business. It's a case of people trying to screw you, okay?
Mm.
It's making a contract with the hospital, and then the hospital decides, oh, a couple years later that maybe they could get somebody cheaper or maybe they could put the doctor on a salary rather than have him bill independently for his services. And those are the ogres I've had to deal with my whole life. And right now I'm kind of retired, so I don't have to deal with corporations trying to make money off my body. The things that corporations will go through to get rid of you is unbelievable. if you want, I'll tell you a 5-minute story if we have time left.
And
it's one of the reasons I quit medicine. And if my wife was still here, she would probably kick my butt for saying this right now. Mm-hmm. But we were at a hospital in Florida, and it was the only hospital in this big hospital's chain of 200 hospitals worldwide at which they couldn't put us on a salary. We were independent physicians. We did our services and we billed for them. So let's say you do a service like a frozen section and you charge $100.
Okay.
Well, the insurance company, the patient gives you that. But if you're on a salary arrangement with the hospital, they get the $100 and they'll pay you $20. So, mm-hmm. you know, it's,
okay. It, okay.
You know the drill. Mm-hmm. So they try to do this to me and my associate, and we sued them, and we won. And, of course, they just can't arbitrarily break your contract if it violates bylaws. They have to hire people to come in and show that you're making mistakes. And it was a very, very stressful period.
Mm-hmm.
So they trumped up a bunch of false mistakes we made, not just me, but my partners as well.
Mm-hmm.
They said we were bad doctors. They fired us. We went to the courts. We won.
Mm-hmm.
They appealed. We won again.
Mm-hmm.
They even took it to the Supreme Court because this large corporation called HCA has $1 billion in legal coffers.
Okay.
And they even lost at the Supreme Court level.
Wow.
But the one thing that they did to get us out of the thing is those same, I guess, is it okay to use the word mercenary or prostitute on your show?
Well, but, I use the disclaimer at the beginning of the show. Ladies and gentlemen, the expressions and comments made by the guests are not those of the host or comments.
Okay. So I could say it.
Okay.
So the hospital got the feds to investigate all of our cases. They hired pathologists, I call them mercenaries or prostitutes, to say that they disagreed with us. And then they made it look like we made mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
And we had I had 48 cases over 5 years that they say I shouldn't have billed for because they were unnecessary. So they called that a felony. They called that a 48 counts of a felony because you bill for it, even though it was only, you know, $40 each. That's a felony. And I got a letter from the feds saying I could go to jail for 10 years for each one of those 48 counts. So if you do the math, that's 480 years. So I'm thinking, well, do you think I could have the lethal injection instead? Anyway, stuff like that happens in medicine all the time. When I teach my course, I warn my students as number one thing is the corporations doing dirty tricks to take away their practices.
Mm-hmm.
They're also regulatory people, and there's malpractice attorneys too. And every one of these groups, the malpractice attorneys, the corporate pimps, and the regulatory agencies, their entire budget depends on how much money they could drain out of us.
Wow.
That was, to me, the greatest.
Wow. Oh, okay. You know, I mentioned a ton of boards and training that you've had, but chairman of the pathology and nuclear medicine.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't mention that. You were.
Well, nuclear medicine is the science of medicine that deals with radioactive isotopes.
Okay.
Sometimes they're used to scan organs, like a lung scan, a bone scan, a liver scan. Some of them actually overlap with the science or the specialty of radiology.
Mm-hmm.
And some of it is used to treat patients with isotopes, people whose thyroids are overactive.
Okay.
We might give some radioactive iodine to slow it down.
Okay.
Or people that have had cancers, we will give them certain isotopes. So it's a wonderful, wonderful specialty. And originally, it was regarded as a branch of pathology. The radiologists also claimed it as a branch. And the internal medicine doctors also claimed it as a branch.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it became kind of independent, and while technically it's still independent, because a lot of the scans now are heart scans. They're doing isotopes to show cardiac function, scanning for heart attacks and heart function. That seems like the cardiologists right now think it's part of cardiology. Yeah. So like a lot of things in medicine, if there's money to be made, everybody wants mm-hmm. to do it.
Chairman, Laboratory Transfusion and Radiation Committee, too.
Right.
So that's what you just...
Right. Sometimes when you are on hospital staff, they force you to be on committees to sit there and decide some of the policies. And often, even if you decide and you have other doctors on your committee, the decision may be made by the people who own the hospital mm-hmm. rather than the doctors who are... wielding sound medical judgments mm-hmm. because money is what's at stake here, right? Not necessarily safety.
But we never seen a Brinks truck behind a hearse yet.
Well, you know what, Dr. Brooks, I think I'll go online and I'll find a picture for you.
Well, is there any time for leisure time activities, or do you have any hobbies?
Yeah, it seems like my whole life is leisure now. I've had several horrible addictions. Probably the biggest one in the last 10 years or 20 years now mm-hmm. have been crossword puzzles.
Oh.
I do them all day. I also have written a few for the New York Times. Now that's kind of weaning off on that addiction, and I'm into Scrabble. There is this game called Words with Friends everybody plays, and I am a Scrabble nut. I love, my biggest outdoor sport is hiking, backpacking, mountain climbing, kayaking. I mean, now that I'm sort of retired, and except for the fact that on Tuesdays and Thursday mornings pretty soon, I'll have to be starting a new course again and preparing for it a day in advance also. Mm-hmm. I have a lot of fun long weekends.
Mm-hmm. Building computers, we can't think of any occupation without computers, but you're in a process of building computers.
Yeah, it's fun. It's easy. I've done hundreds of them.
Oh.
Most people think that, you know, you have to be a rocket scientist to make a computer, but nowadays it's basically like building a Lego house. You just snap things together. The thing that you snap onto everything is called the motherboard.
Okay.
And then the CPU fits on that. And then the fan, and then a couple little RAM chips. And they're all standard sizes. The hard drive, some peripherals, a few little blinking on and off switch. Attach the monitor, attach the mouse, attach the keyboard, and put it into a big box, and that's called a computer. And for the 10 or so years, 20 years, I'll admit it, I've been doing this. It's basically been the same principle, but the electronics has gotten faster and better and smaller as well.
Mm-hmm.
It's a great joy to build a computer.
Tell us about your best friend. He finally, this is the end of the program now, he finally decided to just rest, relax. He's laying down now for the first time.
Well, I guess he might be aware of the fact that we're about ready to sign off, so he probably thinks he's... I see a guy there that says 3 minutes, so Whoopi says, well, it's about time to show them how cute I am.
I guess he reads, too. He just sat there. But he's been very active. And
Whoopi is the one most wonderful
We couldn't dog. Have this show without him. This is the first time that we've done this, and he's been perfect.
Well, Dr. Brooks, do you see how sweet he is?
Yeah, oh, the whole
hour. If somebody
hour.
Decided to break into the studio here and or come at you with a gun or a knife, that person would not have a throat within 3 seconds. Woofy knows what to do.
Okay. Well, he was very friendly towards me that we'll, I guess he's testing me. I guess he said, if I'm your friend, and I'm a friend of his, too. You know, well, we're very happy that you took time for your busy schedule to be with us to talk about your profession, and you're just worldwide. And we mentioned that the things that you do for yourself, and you don't do anything for yourself, they're here, they're gone when you're gone. But the thing that you do for others, like what you're doing now online, free, you know, pathology courts, you know, that will remain as your legacy.
Thank you.
I don't know anyone else that's doing that.
I think a lot of people can. I think when a lot of people retire from medicine, they can either sit in front of the fireplace and the Cracker Barrel and bitch about Medicare all day. Okay. Or they could, my mother used to say, it's better to light one candle than to curse the darkness.
Okay.
And let me tell you, I also disagree with you.
Okay.
You are the man, not me. What you have done for this community is unbelievable. It is such an honor to be on your show. I'd like to be like you when I grow up, but I'm not too sure if I'll ever grow up.
Well, thank you very much. I really appreciate it. And this is, what, my 19th year since I retired. I retired 23 years ago. And radio, I went right into radio 23 years and the 19th year here. Wow. And I just enjoy when I see talent like you, and the audience will know every week, each week. Tomorrow we'll be airing a show on the Center for Independent Living.
Great.
And we took our cameras out to Mundelein, Illinois to do the program out there. And everyone just had a great time out there. We had a love. And it just made my heart feel good to see them, as active and willing to do the program and just as happy as they could be.
And that's your legacy.
Yeah. So I want to thank you again. Ladies and gentlemen, again, we've been talking with Dr. John Minarcik, a MD pathologist from Lake Bluff, Illinois, and he is the creator of the world's first free, real-time, global, complete medical school pathology course, 2010-2011. Director of pathology course, Scholes College of Medicine, Rosalind Franklin University, and the list goes on and on. He has attended North Chicago City Council meetings since the murder of Daryl Dagwood Hannah. North Chicago, and his reflections as a pathologist has been with us today and with North Chicago. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been Community Forum. My name is Dr. Waddell Brooks, Sr., your host.